Section 1 of The First Voyage of James Cook, Volume 2 by James Cook, 1728-1779. The First Voyage of James Cook, Volume 2 by James Cook, 1728-1779. Being the second volume of the three voyages of Captain James Cook round the world, complete in seven volumes. London, Longman, Hurst, Rees, Orme and Brown, 1821. Book 2, Chapter 7, Part 1. Range from Cape Turnagain southward along the eastern coast of Poenammu, round Cape South, and back to the western entrance of Cook Strait, which completed the circumnavigation of this country, with a description of the coast and of Admiralty Bay, the departure from New Zealand, and various particulars. At 4 o'clock in the afternoon of Friday the 9th of February, we tacked and stood southwest till 8 o'clock the next morning, when, being not above 3 or 4 miles from the shore, we stood off 2 hours, and then again southwest till noon, when, at the distance of about 2 miles from the shore, we had 26 fathom water. We continued to make sail to the southward till sunset on the 11th, when a fresh breeze northeast had carried us back again the length of Cape Palliser, of which, as the weather was clear, we had a good view. It is of a height sufficient to be seen in clear weather at the distance of 12 or 14 leagues, and the land is of a broken and hilly surface. Between the foot of the high land and the sea there is a low flat border, off which there are some rocks that appear above water. Between this cape and Cape Turnagain, the land near the shore is, in many places, low and flat, and has a green and pleasant appearance, but farther from the sea it rises into hills. The land between Cape Palliser and Cape Tierra Witta is high and makes in table points. It also seemed to us to form two bays, but we were at too great a distance from this part of the coast to judge accurately from appearances. The wind having been variable with calms, we had advanced no farther by the 12th at noon than latitude 41 degrees 52 minutes, Cape Palliser then bearing north, distant about 5 leagues, and the snowy mountain south 83 degrees west. At noon on the 13th, we found ourselves in the latitude of 42 degrees 2 minutes south, Cape Palliser bearing north 20 degrees east, distant 8 leagues. In the afternoon, a fresh gale sprung up at northeast, and we steered southwest by west for the southernmost land in sight, which at sunset bore from us south 74 degrees west. At this time the variation was 15 degrees 4 minutes east. At 8 o'clock in the morning of the 14th, having run 21 leagues south 58 degrees west since the preceding noon, it fell calm. We were then abreast of the snowy mountain which bore from us northwest, and in this direction lay behind a mountainous ridge of nearly the same height, which rises directly from the sea and runs parallel with the shore, which lies northeast a half north and southwest a half south. The northwest end of the ridge rises inland, not far from Cape Campbell, and both the mountain and the ridge are distinctly seen as well from Cape Koamaru as Cape Palliser. From Koamaru they are distant 2 and 20 leagues southwest a half south, and from Cape Palliser 30 leagues west-southwest, and are of a height sufficient to be seen at a much greater distance. Some persons on board were of opinion that they were as high as Tenerife, but I did not think them as high as Mount Egmont on the southwest coast of Iahainomoa, because the snow, which almost entirely covered Mount Egmont, lay only in patches upon these. At noon this day, we were in latitude 42 degrees 34 minutes south. The southernmost land in sight bore southwest to half west, and some lowland that appeared like an island and lay close under the foot of the ridge bore northwest by north about 5 or 6 leagues. In the afternoon, when Mr. Banks was out in the boat a-shooting, we saw with our glasses 4 double canoes, having on board 57 men, put off from that shore and make towards him. We immediately made signals for him to come on board, but the ship, with respect to him, being right in the wake of the sun, he did not see them. We were at a considerable distance from the shore, and he was at a considerable distance from the ship, which was between him and the shore, so that, it being a dead calm, I began to be in some pain for him, fearing that he might not see the canoes time enough to reach the ship before they should get up with him. Soon after, however, we saw his boat in motion and had the pleasure to take him on board before the Indians came up, who probably had not seen him, as their attention seemed to be wholly fixed upon the ship. They came within about a stone's cast and then stopped, gazing at us with a look of vacant astonishment. Tupia exerted all his eloquence to prevail upon them to come nearer, but without any effect. After surveying us for some time, they left us and made towards the shore, but had not measured more than half the distance between that and the ship before it was dark. We imagined that these people had heard nothing of us, and could not but remark the different behaviour and dispositions of the inhabitants of the different parts of this coast upon their first approaching the vessel. These kept aloof with a mixture of timidity and wonder. Others had immediately commenced hostilities by pelting us with stones. The gentleman whom we had found alone, fishing in his boat, seemed to think us entirely unworthy of his notice. And some, almost without invitation, had come on board with an air of perfect confidence and goodwill. From the behaviour of our last visitors, I gave the land from which they had put off, and which, as I had before observed, had the appearance of an island, the name of Lookers On. At 8 o'clock in the evening, a breeze sprung up at south-southwest, with which I stretched off south-east, because some on board thought they saw land in that quarter. In this course we continued till 6 o'clock the next morning, when we had run 11 leagues, but saw no land, except that which we had left. Having stood to the south-east with a light breeze, which veered from the west to the north till noon, our latitude by observation was 42 degrees 56 minutes south, and the high land that we were abreast of the preceding noon bore north-northwest a half west. In the afternoon we had a light breeze at northeast, with which we steered west, edging in for the land, which was distant about 8 leagues. At 7 in the evening we were about 6 leagues from the shore, and the southernmost extremity of the land in sight bore west-south-west. At daybreak on the 16th we discovered land bearing south by west and seemingly detached from the coast we were upon. About 8 a breeze sprung up at north by east, and we steered directly for it. At noon we were in latitude 43 degrees 19 minutes south. The peak on the snowy mountain bore north 20 degrees east, distant 27 leagues, the southern extremity of the land we could see bore west, and the land which had been discovered in the morning appeared like an island extending from south-southwest to southwest by west a half west, distant about 8 leagues. In the afternoon we stood to the southward of it, with a fresh breeze at north. At 8 in the evening we had run 11 leagues, and the land then extended from southwest by west to north by west. We were then distant about 3 or 4 leagues from the nearest shore, and in this situation had 50 fathom water, with a fine sandy bottom. The variation of the compass by this morning's amplitude was 14 degrees 39 minutes east. At sunrise the next morning, our opinion that the land we had been standing for was an island was confirmed by our seeing part of the land of Tovi Poenamu open to the westward of it, extending as far as west by south. At 8 in the morning, the extremes of the island bore north 76 degrees west and north-northeast a half east, and an opening near the south point, which had the appearance of a bay or harbour, north 20 degrees west, distant between 3 and 4 leagues. In this situation we had 38 fathom water with a brown sandy bottom. This island, which I named after Mr. Banks, lies about 5 leagues from the coast of Tovi Poenamu. The south point bears south 21 degrees west from the highest peak on the snowy mountain, and lies in latitude 43 degrees 32 minutes south, and in longitude 186 degrees 30 minutes west by an observation of the sun and moon, which was made this morning. It is of a circular figure, and about 24 leagues in compass. It is sufficiently high to be seen at the distance of 12 or 15 leagues, and the land has a broken irregular surface, with the appearance rather of barrenness than fertility. Yet it was inhabited, for we saw smoke in one place and a few straggling natives in another. When this island was first discovered in the direction of south by west, some persons on board were of opinion that they also saw land bearing south-southeast and south-east by east. I was myself upon the deck at the time, and told them that in my opinion it was no more than a cloud, and that as the sun rose it would dissipate and vanish. However, as I was determined to leave no subject for disputation which experiment could remove, I ordered the ship to be wore and steered east-south-east by compass in the direction which the land was said to bear from us at that time. At noon we were in latitude 44 degrees 7 minutes south, the south point of Banks's island bearing north, distant 5 leagues. By 7 o'clock at night we had run 8 and 20 miles, when, seeing no land, nor any signs of any, but that which we had left, we bore away south by west, and continued upon that course till the next day at noon, when we were in latitude 45 degrees 16 minutes, the south point of Banks's island bearing north 6 degrees 30 minutes west, distant 28 leagues. The variation by the azimuth this morning was 15 degrees 30 minutes east. As no signs of land had yet appeared to the southward, and as I thought that we had stood far enough in that direction to weather all the land we had left, judging from the report of the natives in Queen Charlotte Sound, I hauled to the westward. We had a moderate breeze at north-northwest and north till 8 in the evening, when it became unsettled, and at 10 fixed at south. During the night it blew with such violence that it brought us under our close reef topsails. At 8 the next morning, having run 28 leagues, upon a west by north a half north course, and judging ourselves to be to the westward of the land of Tovi Poenamu, we bore away northwest with a fresh gale at south. At 10, having run 11 miles upon this course, we saw land extending from the southwest to the northwest at the distance of about 10 leagues, which we hauled up for. At noon, our latitude by observation was 44 degrees 38 minutes. The southeast point of Banks's Island bore north 58 degrees 30 minutes east, distant 30 leagues, and the main body of the land in sight west by north. A head sea prevented us from making much way to the southward. At 7 in the evening, the extremes of the land stretched from southwest by south to north by west, and at 6 leagues from the shore we had 32 fathom water. At 4 o'clock the next morning, we stood in for the shore west by south, and during a course of 4 leagues, our depth of water was from 32 to 13 fathom. When it was 13 fathom, we were but 3 miles distant from the shore, and therefore stood off. Its direction is here nearly north and south. The surface, to the distance of about 5 miles from the sea, is low and flat, but it then rises into hills of a considerable height. It appeared to be totally barren, and we saw no signs of it being inhabited. Our latitude at noon was 44 degrees 44 minutes, and the longitude which we made from Banks's Island to this place was 2 degrees 22 minutes west. During the last 24 hours, though we carried as much sail as the ship would bear, we were driven 3 leagues to the leeward. We continued to stand off and on all this day and the next, keeping at the distance of between 4 and 12 leagues from the shore, and having water from 35 to 53 fathom. On the 22nd at noon, we had no observation, but by the land judged ourselves to be about 3 leagues farther north than we had been the day before. At sunset, the weather, which had been hazy, clearing up, we saw a mountain which rose in a high peak, bearing northwest by north, and at the same time we saw the land more distinctly than before, extending from north to southwest by south, which, at some distance within the coast, had a lofty and mountainous appearance. We soon found that the accounts which had been given us by the Indians in Queen Charlotte Sound of the land to the southward were not true, for they had told us that it might be circumnavigated in 4 days. On the 23rd, having a hollow swell from the southeast and expecting wind from the same quarter, we kept plying between 7 and 15 leagues from the shore, having from 70 to 44 fathom. At noon, our latitude by observation was 44 degrees 40 minutes south, and our longitude from Banks's Island 1 degree 31 minutes west. From this time to 6 in the evening, it was calm, but a light breeze then springing up at east-northeast, we steered south-southeast all night, edging off from the land, the hollow swell still continuing. Our depth of water was from 60 to 75 fathom. While we were becalmed, Mr. Banks, being out in the boat, shot 2 Port Egmont hens, which were in every respect the same as those that are found in great numbers upon the island of Faro, and were the first of the kind we had seen upon this coast, though we fell in with some a few days before we made land. At daybreak, the wind freshened, and before noon, we had a strong gale at north-northeast. At 8 in the morning, we saw the land extending as far as southwest by south, and steered directly for it. At noon, we were in latitude 45 degrees 22 minutes south, and at the land, which now stretched from southwest to half south to north northwest, appeared to be rudely diversified by hill and valley. In the afternoon we steered southwest by south and southwest, edging in for the land with a fresh gale at north. But though we were at no great distance, the weather was so hazy that we could see nothing distinctly upon it, except a ridge of high hills lying not far from the sea and parallel to the coast, which in this place stretches south by west and north by east, and seemed to end in a high bluff point to the southward. By 8 in the evening we were abreast of this point, but it being then dark, and I not knowing which way the land trended, we brought to for the night. At this time the point bore west, and was distant about 5 miles. Our depth of water was 37 fathom, and the bottom consisted of small pebbles. At daybreak, having made sail, the point bore north, distant 3 leagues, and we now found that the land trended from it southwest by west as far as we could see. This point I named Cape Saunders in honour of Sir Charles. Our latitude was 45 degrees 35 minutes south and longitude 189 degrees 4 minutes west. By the latitude and the angles that are made by the coast, this point will be sufficiently known. There is, however, about 3 or 4 leagues to the southwest of it, and very near the shore, a remarkable saddle hill, which is a good direction to it on that quarter. From 1 league to 4 leagues north of Cape Saunders, the shore forms 2 or 3 bays, in which there appeared to be good anchorage, and effectual shelter from the southwest westerly and northwesterly winds. But my desire of getting to the southward, in order to ascertain whether this country was an island or a continent, prevented my putting into any of them. We kept at a small distance from the shore all this morning, with the wind at southwest, and had a very distinct view of it. It is of a moderate height, and the surface is broken by many hills, which are green and woody, but we saw no appearance of inhabitants. At noon, Cape Saunders bore north 30 degrees west, distant about 4 leagues. We had variable winds and calms till 5 o'clock in the evening, when it fixed at west-southwest and soon blew so hard that it put us past our topsails and split the foresail all to pieces. After getting another to the yard, we continued to stand to the southward under 2 courses, and at 6 the next morning, the southernmost land in sight bore west by north and Cape Saunders north by west, distant 8 leagues. At noon it bore north 20 degrees west, 14 leagues, and our latitude by observation was 46 degrees 36 minutes. The gale continued with heavy squalls and a large hollow sea all the afternoon, and at 7 in the evening we lay to under our foresail with the ship's head to the southward. At noon on the 27th our latitude was 46 degrees 54 minutes and our longitude from Cape Saunders 1 degree 24 minutes east. At 7 in the evening we made sail under our courses, and at 8 the next morning set the topsails close reefed. At noon our latitude was 47 degrees 43 minutes, and our longitude east from Cape Saunders 2 degrees 10 minutes. At this time we wore and stood to the northward. In the afternoon we found the variation to be 16 degrees 34 minutes east. At 8 in the evening we tacked and stood to the southward, with the wind at west. At noon this day our latitude by account was 47 degrees 52 minutes and our longitude from Cape Saunders 1 degree 8 minutes east. We stood to the southward till 3:30 in the afternoon, and then, being in latitude 48 degrees south and longitude 188 degrees west, and seeing no appearance of land, we tacked and stood to the northward, having a large swell from the southwest by west. At noon the next day, our latitude was 46 degrees 42 minutes south, and Cape Saunders bore north 46 degrees west, distant 86 miles. The southwest swell, continuing till the 3rd, confirmed our opinion that there was no land in that quarter. At 4 in the afternoon, we stood to the westward with all the sail we could make. In the morning of the 4th, we found the variation to be 16 degrees 16 minutes east. This day we saw some whales and seals, as we had done several times after our having passed the strait. But we saw no seal while we were up on the coast of Ehanamawe. We sounded both in the night and this morning, but had no ground with 150 fathom. At noon we saw Cape Saunders bearing north a half west, and our latitude by observation was 46 degrees 31 minutes south. At half an hour past 1 o'clock, we saw land bearing west by south, which we steered for, and before it was dark were within 3 or 4 miles of it. During the whole night we saw fires upon it, and at 7 in the morning were within about 3 leagues of the shore, which appeared to be high but level. At 3 o'clock in the afternoon, we saw the land extending from northeast by north to northwest a half north, and soon after we discovered some lowland, which appeared like an island, bearing south a half west. We continued our course to the west by south, and in 2 hours we saw high land over the lowland, extending to the southward as far as southwest by south, but did not appear to be joined to the land to the northward, so that there is either water, a deep bay, or lowland between them. At noon on the 6th, we were nearly in the same situation as at noon on the day before. In the afternoon we found the variation by several azimuths and the amplitude to be 15 degrees 10 minutes east. On the 7th at noon we were in latitude 47 degrees 6 minutes south, and had made 12 miles easting during the last 24 hours. We stood to the westward the remainder of this day, and all the next till sunset, when the extremes of the land bore from north by east to west, distant about 7 or 8 leagues. In this situation our depth of water was 55 fathom, and the variation by amplitude 16 degrees 29 minutes east. The wind now veered from the north to the west, and as we had fine weather and moonlight, we kept standing close upon the wind to the southwest all night. At 4 in the morning we had 60 fathom water, and at daylight we discovered under our bow a ledge of rocks extending from south by west to west by south, upon which the sea broke very high. They were not more than 3/4 of a mile distant, yet we had 5 and 40 fathom water. As the wind was at northwest, we could not now weather them, and as I was unwilling to run to leeward, I tacked and made a trip to the eastward. The wind, however, soon after coming to the northward, enabled us to get clear of all. Our soundings, while we were passing within the ledge, were from 35 to 47 fathom, with a rocky bottom. This ledge lies southeast 6 leagues from the southernmost part of the land, and southeast by east from some remarkable hills which stand near the shore. About 3 leagues to the northward of it, there is another ledge, which lies full 3 leagues from the shore, and on which the sea broke in a dreadful surf. As we passed these rocks to the north in the night, and discovered the others under our bow at break of day, it is manifest that our danger was imminent, and our escape critical in the highest degree. From the situation of these rocks, so well adapted to catch unwary strangers, I called them the traps. Our latitude at noon was 47 degrees 26 minutes south. The land in sight, which had the appearance of an island, extended from northeast by north to northwest by west, and seemed to be about 5 leagues distant from the main. The easternmost ledge of rocks bore south-southeast, distant 1.5 leagues, and the northernmost northeast 1/2 east, distant about 3 leagues. This land is high and barren, with nothing upon it but a few straggling shrubs, for not a single tree was to be seen. It was, however, remarkable for a number of white patches, which I took to be marble, as they reflected the sun's rays very strongly. Other patches of the same kind we had observed in different parts of this country, particularly in Mercury Bay. We continued to stand close upon a wind to the westward, and at sunset the southernmost point of land bore north 38 degrees east, distant 4 leagues, and the westernmost land in sight bore north 2 degrees east. The point which lies in latitude 47 degrees 19 minutes south, longitude 192 degrees 12 minutes west, I named South Cape. The westernmost land was a small island lying off the point of the main. Supposing South Cape to be the southern extremity of this country, as indeed it proved to be, I hoped to get round it by the west, for a large hollow swell from the southwest, ever since our last hard gale, had convinced me there was no land in that direction. End of section 1. Section 2 of The First Voyage of James Cook, Volume 2 by James Cook, 1728-1779. Book 2, Chapter 7, Part 2. Range from Cape Turnagain southward along the eastern coast of Poenammu, round Cape South and back to the western entrance of Cook Strait, which completed the circumnavigation of this country, with a description of the coast and of Admiralty Bay, the departure from New Zealand, and various particulars, continued. In the night we had a hard gale at northeast by north and north, which brought us under our courses, but about 8 in the morning it became moderate, and at noon, veering to the west, we tacked and stood to the northward, having no land in sight. Our latitude by observation was 47 degrees 33 minutes south, our longitude west from the South Cape 59 minutes. We stood away north-northeast close upon a wind, without seeing any land, till 2 the next morning, when we discovered an island bearing northwest by north, distant about 5 leagues. About 2 hours afterwards we saw land ahead, upon which we tacked and stood off till 6, when we stood in to take a nearer view of it. At 11 we were within 3 leagues of it, but the wind seeming to incline upon the shore, I tacked and stood off to the southward. We had now sailed round the land which we had discovered on the 5th, and which then did not appear to be joined to the main, which lay north of it. And being now come to the other side of what we supposed to be water, a bay or lowland, it had the same appearance, but when I came to lay it down upon paper, I saw no reason to suppose it to be an island. On the contrary, I was clearly of opinion that it made part of the main. At noon, the western extremity of the main bore north 59 degrees west, and the island which we had seen in the morning south 59 degrees west, distant about 5 leagues. It lies in latitude 46 degrees 31 minutes south, longitude 192 degrees 49 minutes west, and is nothing but a barren rock about a mile in circuit, remarkably high, and lies full 5 leagues distant from the main. This island I named after Dr. Zollander, and called it Zollander's Island. The shore of the main lies nearest east by south and west by north, and forms a large open bay, in which there is no appearance of any harbour or shelter for shipping, against southwest and southerly winds. The surface of the country is broken into craggy hills of a great height, on the summits of which are several patches of snow. It is not, however, wholly barren, for we could see wood not only in the valleys, but upon the highest ground, yet we saw no appearance of its being inhabited. We continued to stand to the southwest by south till 11 o'clock the next morning, when the wind shifted to the southwest by west, upon which we wore, and stood to the north-northwest, being then in latitude 47 degrees 40 minutes south, longitude 193 degrees 50 minutes west, and having a hollow sea from the southwest. During the night we steered north-northwest till 6 in the morning, when, seeing no land, we steered north by east till 8, when we steered north-east by east a half east to make the land, which at 10 we saw bearing east-north-east, but it being hazy, we could distinguish nothing upon it. At noon our latitude by observation was 46 degrees south. About 2 it cleared up, and the land appeared to be high, rude, and mountainous. About half an hour after 3, I hauled in for a bay, in which there appeared to be good anchorage, but in about an hour, finding the distance too great to run before it would be dark, and the wind blowing too hard to make the attempt safe in the night, I bore away along the shore. This bay, which I called Dusky Bay, lies in latitude 45 degrees 47 minutes south. It is between 3 and 4 miles broad at the entrance, and seems to be full as deep as it is broad. It contains several islands, behind which there must be shelter from all winds, though possibly there may not be sufficient depth of water. The north point of this bay, when it bears southeast by south, is rendered very remarkable by 5 high-peaked rocks which lie off it, and have the appearance of the 4 fingers and thumb of a man's hand, for which reason I called it Point 5 Fingers. The land of this point is farther remarkable for being the only level land within a considerable distance. It extends near 2 leagues to the northward, is lofty and covered with wood. The land behind it is very different, consisting wholly of mountains, totally barren and rocky. And this difference gives the cape the appearance of an island. At sunset, the southernmost land in sight bore due south, distant about 5 or 6 leagues. And as this is the westernmost point of land upon the whole coast, I called it West Cape. It lies about 3 leagues to the southward of Dusky Bay, in the latitude of 45 degrees 54 minutes south, and in the longitude of 193 degrees 17 minutes west. The land of this cape is of a moderate height next the sea, and has nothing remarkable about it, except a very white cliff, 2 or 3 leagues to the southward of it. To the southward of it also the land trends away to the southeast, and to the northward it trends north-northeast. Having brought to for the night, we made sail along the shore at 4 in the morning, in the direction of northeast a half north, with a moderate breeze at south-southeast. At noon, our latitude by observation was 45 degrees 30 minutes south. At this time, being about a league and a half from the shore, we sounded, but had no ground with 70 fathom. We had just passed a small narrow opening inland, where there seemed to be a very safe and convenient harbour, formed by an island, which lay in the middle of the opening at east. The opening lies in latitude 45 degrees 16 minutes south, and on the land behind it are mountains, the summits of which were covered with snow, that appeared to have been recently fallen. And indeed, for 2 days past, we had found the weather very cold. On each side of the entrance of the opening, the land rises almost perpendicularly from the sea to a stupendous height. And this indeed was the reason why I did not carry the ship into it, for no wind could blow there but right in or right out, in the direction of either east or west, and I thought it by no means advisable to put into a place whence I could not have got out but with a wind which experience had taught me did not blow more than 1 day in a month. In this, however, I acted contrary to the opinion of some persons on board, who in very strong terms expressed their desire to harbour for present convenience, without any regard to future disadvantages. In the evening, being about 2 leagues from the shore, we sounded, and had no ground with 108 fathom. The variation of the needle by azimuth was 14 degrees east, and by amplitude 15 degrees 2 minutes. We made the best of our way along the shore with what wind we had, keeping at the distance of between 2 and 3 leagues. At noon we were in latitude 44 degrees 47 minutes, having run only 12 leagues upon a northeast 1/4 north course during the last 4 and 20 hours. We continued to steer along the shore in the direction of northeast 1/4 east till 6 o'clock in the evening, when we brought to for the night. At 4 in the morning we stood in for the land, and when the day broke we saw what appeared to be an inlet, but upon a nearer approach proved to be only a deep valley between 2 highlands. We proceeded therefore in the same course, keeping the shore at the distance of between 4 and 5 miles. At noon on the 16th, the northernmost point of land in sight bore north 60 degrees east at the distance of 10 miles, and our latitude by observation was 44 degrees 5 minutes, our longitude from Cape West 2 degrees 8 minutes east. About 2 we passed the point which at noon had been distant 10 miles, and found it to consist of high red cliffs, down which there fell a cascade of water in 4 small streams, and I therefore gave it the name of Cascade Point. From this point the land trends first north 76 degrees east, and afterwards more to the northward. At the distance of 8 leagues from Cascade Point, in the direction of east-northeast, and at a little distance from the shore, lies a small low island, which bore from us south by east at the distance of about 1.5 leagues. At 7 in the evening we brought to, in 33 fathom, with a fine sandy bottom. At 10 we had 50 fathom, and at 12 wore in 65 fathom, having driven several miles north-northwest after our having brought to. At 2 in the morning we had no ground with 140 fathom, by which it appears that the soundings extend but a little way from the shore. About this time it fell calm. At 8 a breeze sprung up at southwest, with which we steered along the shore, in the direction of northeast by east a half east, at the distance of about 3 leagues. At 6 in the evening, being about 1 league from the shore, we had 17 fathom, and at 8, being about 3 leagues from the shore, we had 44. We now shortened sail and brought to, having run 10 leagues northeast by east since noon. It was calm most part of the night, but at 10 in the morning, a light breeze sprung up at southwest by west, when we made sail again along the shore, northeast by north, having a large swell from the west-southwest, which had risen in the night. At noon, our latitude by observation was 43 degrees 4 minutes south, and our longitude from Cape West 4 degrees 12 minutes east. We observed that the valleys as well as the mountains were this morning covered with snow, part of which we supposed to have fallen during the night, when we had rain. At 6 in the evening we shortened sail, and at 10 brought to, at the distance of about 5 leagues from the shore, where we had 115 fathom. At midnight, there being little wind, we made sail, and at 8 in the morning we stood to the northeast close upon a wind till noon, when we tacked, being about 3 leagues from the land, and, by observation, in latitude 42 degrees 8 minutes, and longitude from Cape West 5 degrees 5 minutes east. We continued to stand westward till 2 in the morning, when we made a trip to the eastward, and afterwards stood westward till noon, when, by our reckoning, we were in the latitude 42 degrees 23 minutes, and longitude from Cape West 3 degrees 55 minutes east. We now tacked and stood eastward, with a fresh gale at north by west, till 6 in the evening, when the wind shifted to the south and south-southwest, with which we steered northeast by north till 6 in the morning, when we hauled in east by north to make the land, which we saw soon afterwards. At noon our latitude by account was 41 degrees 37 minutes, and our longitude from Cape West 5 degrees 42 minutes east. We were now within 3 or 4 leagues of the land, but it being foggy, we could see nothing upon it distinctly, and as we had much wind and a vast swell rolling in upon the shore from the west-south-west, I did not think it safe to go nearer. In the afternoon we had a gentle breeze from the south-south-west, with which we steered north along the shore till 8, when, being within 2 and 3 leagues, we sounded, and had but 34 fathom, upon which we hauled off northwest by north till 11 at night, and then brought to, having 64 fathom. At 4 in the morning we made sail to the northeast with a light breeze at south-southwest, which at 8 veered to the westward, and soon after died away. At this time we were within 3 or 4 miles of the land, and had 54 fathom, with a large swell from the west-south-west rolling obliquely upon the shore, which made me fear that I should be obliged to anchor. But by the help of a light air now and then from the south-west, I was able to keep the ship from driving. At noon the northernmost land in sight bore northeast by east a half east, distant about 10 leagues. Our latitude by account was 40 degrees 55 minutes south, longitude from Cape West 6 degrees 35 minutes east. From this time we had light airs from the southward, with intervals of calm, till noon on the 23rd, when our latitude by observation was 40 degrees 36 minutes 30 seconds south, and our longitude from Cape West 6 degrees 52 minutes east. The easternmost point of land in sight bore east 10 degrees north at the distance of 7 leagues, and a bluff head or point, of which we had been abreast at noon the day before, and off which lay some rocks above water, bore south 18 degrees west at the distance of 6 leagues. This point I called Rocks Point. Our latitude was now 40 degrees 55 minutes south, and having nearly run down the whole of the northwest coast of Tovi Poenanu, I shall give some account of the face of the country. I have already observed that on the 11th, when we were off the southern part, the land then seen was craggy and mountainous, and there is great reason to believe that the same ridge of mountains extends nearly the whole length of the island. Between the westernmost land which we saw that day, and the easternmost which we saw on the 13th, there is a space of about 6 or 8 leagues, of which we did not see the coast, though we plainly discovered the mountains inland. The sea coast near Cape West is low, rising with an easy and gradual ascent to the foot of the mountains, and being in most parts covered with wood. From Point Five Fingers down to latitude 44 degrees 20 minutes, there is a narrow ridge of hills that rises directly from the sea and is covered with wood. Close behind these hills are the mountains, extending in another ridge of a stupendous height, and consisting of rocks that are totally barren and naked, except where they are covered with snow, which is to be seen in large patches upon many parts of them, and has probably lain there ever since the creation of the world. A prospect more rude, craggy, and desolate than this country affords from the sea cannot possibly be conceived, for, as far inland as the eye can reach, nothing appears but the summits of rocks, which stand so near together that instead of valleys there are only fissures between them. From the latitude of 44 degrees 20 minutes to the latitude of 42 degrees 8 minutes, these mountains lie farther inland, and the sea coast consists of woody hills and valleys of various height and extent, and has much appearance of fertility. Many of the valleys form plains of considerable extent, wholly covered with wood, but it is very probable that the ground in many places is swampy and interspersed with pools of water. From latitude 42 degrees 8 minutes to 41 degrees 30 minutes, the land is not distinguished by anything remarkable. It rises into hills directly from the sea and is covered with wood. But the weather being foggy while we were upon this part of the coast, we could see very little inland, except now and then the summits of the mountains, towering above the cloudy mists that obscured them below, which confirmed my opinion that a chain of mountains extended from one end of the island to the other. In the afternoon we had a gentle breeze at southwest, which, before it was quite dark, brought us abreast of the eastern point which we had seen at noon, but not knowing what course the land took on the other side of it, we brought to in 34 fathom, at the distance of about 1 league from the shore. At 8 in the evening, there being little wind, we filled and stood on till midnight, and then we brought to till 4 in the morning, when we again made sail, and at break of day we saw lowland extending from the point to the south-south-east as far as the eye could reach, the eastern extremity of which appeared in round hillocks. By this time the gale had veered to the eastward, which obliged us to ply to windward. At noon next day the eastern point bore southwest by south, distant 16 miles, and our latitude was 40 degrees 19 minutes. The wind continuing easterly, we were nearly in the same situation at noon on the day following. About 3 o'clock, the wind came to the westward, and we steered east-south-east with all the sail we could set till it was dark, and then shortened sail till the morning. As we had thick, hazy weather all night, we kept sounding continually, and had from 37 to 42 fathom. When the day broke, we saw land bearing south-east by east, and an island lying near it, bearing east-south-east, distant about 5 leagues. This island I knew to be the same that I had seen from the entrance of Queen Charlotte Sound, from which it bears northwest by north, distant 9 leagues. At noon it bore south, distant 4 or 5 miles, and the northwest head of the sound, southeast by south, distant 10 leagues and a half. Our latitude by observation was 40 degrees 33 minutes south. As we had now circumnavigated the whole country, it became necessary to think of quitting it. But as I had 30 tons of empty water casks on board, this could not be done till I had filled them. I therefore hauled round the island and entered a bay, which lies between that and Queen Charlotte Sound, leaving 3 more islands, which lay close under the western shore, between 3 or 4 miles within the entrance, on our starboard hand. While we were running in, we kept the lead continually going, and had from 40 to 12 fathom. At 6 o'clock in the evening, we anchored in 11 fathom, with a muddy bottom, under the west shore in the second cove, that lies within 3 islands. And as soon as it was light the next morning, I took a boat and went on shore to look for a watering place and a proper berth for the ship, both which I found, much to my satisfaction. As soon as the ship was moored, I sent an officer on shore to superintend the watering, and the carpenter, with his crew, to cut wood, while the longboat was employed in landing the empty casks. In this employment we were busy till the 30th, when the wind seeming to settle at south-east, and our water being nearly completed, we warped the ship out of the cove, that we might have room to get under sail. And at noon I went away in the pinnace to examine as much of the bay as my time would admit. After rowing about 2 leagues up it, I went ashore upon a point of land on the western side, and having climbed a hill, I saw the western arm of this bay run in southwest by west about 5 leagues farther, yet I could not discover the end of it. There appeared to be several other inlets, or at least small bays, between this and the northwest head of Queen Charlotte Sound, in each of which, I make no doubt, there is anchorage and shelter, as they are all covered from the sea wind by the islands which lie without them. The land about this bay, as far as I could see of it, is of a hilly surface, chiefly covered with trees, shrubs, and fern, which render travelling difficult and fatiguing. In this excursion I was accompanied by Mr. Banks and Dr. Zollander, who found several new plants. We met with some huts, which seemed to have been long deserted, but saw no inhabitants. Mr. Banks examined several of the stones that lay upon the beach, which were full of veins and had a mineral appearance, but he did not discover anything in them which he knew to be ore. If he had had an opportunity to examine any of the bare rocks, perhaps he might have been more fortunate. He was also of opinion that what I had taken for marble in another place was a mineral substance, and that, considering the correspondence of latitude between this place and South America, it was not improbable but that, by a proper examination, something very valuable might be found. At my return in the evening, I found all the wood and water on board, and the ship ready for the sea. I resolved, therefore, to quit the country, and return home by such a route as might be of most advantage to the service, and upon this subject took the opinion of my officers. I had myself a strong desire to return by Cape Horn, because that would have enabled me finally to determine whether there is or is not a southern continent. But against this it was a sufficient objection that we must have kept in a high southern latitude in the very depth of winter, with a vessel which was not thought sufficient for the undertaking. And the same reason was urged against our proceeding directly for the Cape of Good Hope, with still more force, because no discovery of moment could be hoped for in that route. It was therefore resolved that we should return by the East Indies, and that with this view we should, upon leaving the coast, steer westward, till we should fall in with the east coast of New Holland, and then follow the direction of that coast to the northward, till we should arrive at its northern extremity. But if that should be found impracticable, it was further resolved that we should endeavour to fall in with the land, or islands, said to have been discovered by Quiros. With this view, at break of day on Saturday, the 31st of March, 1770, we got under sail and put to sea, with the advantage of a fresh gale at southeast and clear weather, taking our departure from the eastern point, which we had seen at noon on the 23rd, and to which, on this occasion, I gave the name of Cape Farewell. The bay out of which we had just sailed I called Admiralty Bay, giving the name of Cape Stevens to the northwest point, and Cape Jackson to the southeast, after the two gentlemen who at this time were secretaries to the board. Admiralty Bay may easily be known by the island that has just been mentioned, which lies 2 miles northeast of Cape Stevens, in latitude 40 degrees 37 minutes south, longitude 185 degrees 6 minutes west, and is of a considerable height. Between this island and Cape Farewell, which are between 14 and 15 leagues distant from each other, in the direction of west by north and east by south, the shore forms a large deep bay, the bottom of which we could scarcely see while we were sailing in a straight line from one cape to the other. It is, however, probably of less depth than it appeared to be, for as we found the water shallower here than at the same distance from any other part of the coast, there is reason to suppose that the land at the bottom which lies next to the sea is low, and therefore not easily to be distinguished from it. I have for this reason called it Blind Bay, and am of opinion that it is the same which was called Murderer's Bay by Tasman. Such particulars of this country and its inhabitants, with their manners and customs, as could be learnt while we were circumnavigating the coast, shall now be related. End of section 2. Section 3 of the First Voyage of James Cook, Volume 2, by James Cook, 1728-1779. Book 2, Chapter 8. A General Account of New Zealand, Its First Discovery, Situation, Extent, Climate, and Productions. New Zealand was first discovered by Abel Janssen Tasman, a Dutch navigator whose name has been several times mentioned in this narrative, on the 13th of December in the year 1642. He traversed the eastern coast from latitude 34 degrees to 43 degrees, and entered the strait which divides the two islands, and in the chart is called Cook's Strait. But being attacked by the natives soon after he came to an anchor, in the place to which he gave the name of Murderer's Bay, he never went on shore. He gave the country the name of Staatenland, or the Land of the States, in honour of the States General, and it is now generally distinguished in our maps and charts by the name of New Zealand. As the whole of this country, except that part of the coast which was seen by Tasman from on board his ship, has from his time to the voyage of the Endeavour remained altogether unknown, it has by many been supposed to be part of a southern continent. It is, however, now known to consist of two large islands, divided from each other by a strait or passage, which is about 4 or 5 leagues broad. These islands are situated between the latitude of 34 degrees and 48 degrees south, and between the longitudes of 181 degrees and 194 degrees west, which is now determined with uncommon exactness from innumerable observations of the sun and moon, and one of the transits of Mercury, by Mr. Green, a person of known abilities, who, as has been mentioned before, was sent out by the Royal Society to observe the transit of Venus in the South Seas. The northernmost of these islands is called by the natives Ehinamawe, and the southernmost Tovi or Tove Hoenamo. Yet, as I have observed before, we are not sure whether the name Tovi Poenamu comprehends the whole southern island or only part of it. The figure and extent of these islands, with the situation of the bays and harbours they contain, and the smaller islands that lie about them, will appear from the chart that I have drawn, every part of which, however, I cannot vouch to be equally accurate. The coast of our Ehinamawe, from Cape Palliser to East Cape, is laid down with great exactness, both in its figure and the course and distance from point to point. For the opportunities that offered, and the methods that I used, were such as could scarcely admit of an error. From East Cape to St. Maria van Diemen, the chart, though perhaps not equally exact, is without any error of moment, except possibly in some few places which are here, and in other parts of the chart, distinguished by a dotted line, and which I had no opportunity to examine. From Cape Maria van Diemen to latitude 36 degrees 15 minutes, we were seldom nearer the shore than between 5 and 8 leagues, and therefore the line that marks the sea coast may possibly be erroneous. From latitude 36 degrees 15 minutes to nearly the length of Entry Island, our course was very near the shore, and in this part of the chart, therefore, there can be no material error, except perhaps at Cape Tierrawitta. Between Entry Island and Cape Palliser, we were again farther from the shore, and this part of the coast, therefore, may not be laid down with minute exactness. Yet, upon the whole, I am of opinion that this island will be found not much to differ from the figure that I have given it, and that upon the coast there are few or no harbours which are not noticed in the journal, or delineated in the chart. I cannot, however, say as much of Tovi Poenamu. The season of the year and the circumstances of the voyage would not permit me to spend so much time about this island as I had employed upon the other, and the storms that we met with made it both difficult and dangerous to keep near the shore. However, from Queen Charlotte Sound to Cape Campbell, and as far to the southwest as latitude 43 degrees, the chart will be found pretty accurate. Between latitude 43 degrees and latitude 44 degrees 20 minutes, the line may be doubted, for of some part of the coast which it represents, we had scarcely a view. From latitude 44 degrees 20 minutes to Cape Saunders, our distance would not permit me to be particular, and the weather was besides extremely unfavourable. From Cape Saunders to Cape South, and even to Cape West, there is also reason to fear that the chart will in many places be found erroneous, as we were seldom able to keep the shore, and were sometimes blown to such a distance that it could not be seen. From Cape West to Cape Farewell, and even to Charlotte Sound, it is not more to be trusted. Tovi Poenammu is for the most part a mountainous, and to all appearance a barren country, and the people whom we saw in Queen Charlotte Sound, those that came off to us under the snowy mountains, and the fires to the west of Cape Saunders, were all the inhabitants, and signs of inhabitants, that we discovered upon the whole island. A. Hainamawe has a much better appearance. It is indeed not only hilly but mountainous, yet even the hills and mountains are covered with wood, and every valley has a rivulet of water. The soil in these valleys and in the plains, of which there are many that are not overgrown with wood, is in general light but fertile, and in the opinion of Mr. Banks and Dr. Zollander, as well as of every other gentleman on board, all kinds of European grain, plants, and fruit would flourish here in the utmost luxuriance. From the vegetables that we found here, there is reason to conclude that the winters are milder than those in England, and we found the summer not hotter, though it was more equally warm, so that if this country should be settled by people from Europe, they would, with a little industry, be very soon supplied not only with the necessaries, but the luxuries of life in great abundance. In this country there are no quadrupeds but dogs and rats. At least we saw no other, and the rats are so scarce that many of us never saw them. The dogs live with the people, who breed them for no other purpose than to eat. There might indeed be quadrupeds that we did not see, but this is not probable, because the chief pride of the natives, with respect to their dress, is in the skins and hair of such animals as they have, and we never saw the skin of any animal about them but those of dogs and birds. There are indeed seals upon the coast, and we once saw a sea lion, but we imagine that they are seldom caught, for though we saw some of their teeth, which were fastened into an ornament like a bodkin, and worn by the natives at their breast, and highly valued, we saw none of their skins. There are whales also upon this coast, and though the people did not appear to have any art or instrument by which such an animal could be taken and killed, we saw patu-patus in the possession of some of them, which were made of the bone of a whale or of some other animal whose bone had exactly the same appearance. Of birds, the species are not many, and of these none, except perhaps the gannet, is the same with those of Europe. Here are ducks indeed, and shags of several kinds, sufficiently resembling those of Europe to be called the same by those who have not examined them very nicely. Here are also hawks, owls, and quails, which differ but little from those of Europe at first sight, and several small birds whose song, as has been remarked in the course of this narrative, is much more melodious than any that we had ever heard. The sea coast is also visited by many oceanic birds, particularly albatrosses, shearwaters, pintados, and a few of the birds which Sir John Narborough has called penguins, and which indeed are what the French call nuance, and seem to be a middle species between bird and fish. For their feathers, especially those upon their wings, differ very little from scales, and their wings themselves, which they use only in diving, and not to accelerate their motion, even upon the surface of the water, may, perhaps with equal propriety, be called fins. Neither are insects in greater plenty than birds. A few butterflies and beetles, flesh flies, very like those in Europe, and some mosquitoes and sand flies, perhaps exactly the same with those of North America, make up the whole catalogue. Of mosquitoes and sand flies, however, which are justly accounted the curse of every country where they abound, we did not see many. There were indeed a few in almost every place where we went on shore, but they gave us so little trouble that we did not make use of the shades which we had provided for the security of our faces. For this scarcity of animals upon the land, the sea, however, makes an abundant recompense. Every creek swarming with fish, which are not only wholesome, but equally delicious with those of Europe. The ship seldom anchored in any station, or with a light gale past any place, that did not afford us enough with hook and line to serve the whole ship's company, especially to the southward. When we lay at anchor, the boats, with hook and line, near the rocks, could take fish in any quantity, and the Seine seldom failed of producing a still more ample supply, so that both times when we anchored in Cook Strait, every mess in the ship, that was not careless and improvident, salted as much as lasted many weeks after they went to sea. Of this article the variety was equal to the plenty. We had mackerel of many kinds, among which one was exactly the same as we have in England. These came in immense shoals, and were taken by the natives in their sens, who sold them to us at a very easy rate. Beside these, there were fish of many species which we had never seen before, but to all which the seamen very readily gave names, so that we talked here as familiarly of hakes, bream, coalfish, and many others, as we do in England. And though they are by no means of the same family, it must be confessed that they do honour to the name. But the highest luxury which the sea afforded us, even in this place, was the lobster or sea crayfish, which are probably the same that in the account of Lord Anson's voyage are said to have been found at the island of Juan Fernandez, except that, though large, they are not quite equal in size. They differ from ours in England in several particulars. They have a greater number of prickles on their backs, and they are red when first taken out of the water. These we also bought everywhere to the northward in great quantities of the natives, who catch them by diving near the shore and finding out where they lie with their feet. We had also a fish that Frezier, in his voyage to the Spanish main in South America, has described by the names of elephant, pahagallo, or poison cock, which, though coarse, we eat very heartily. Several species of the skate or stingray are also found here, which were still coarser than the elephant, but as an atonement, we had among many kinds of dogfish one spotted with white, which was in flavour exactly similar to our best skate, but much more delicious. We had also flatfish resembling both soles and flounders, besides eels and congers of various kinds, with many others of which those who shall hereafter visit this coast will not fail to find the advantage, and shellfish in great variety, particularly clams, cockles, and oysters. Among the vegetable productions of this country, the trees claim a principal place. For here are forests of vast extent, full of the straightest, the cleanest, and the largest timber trees that we had ever seen. Their size, their grain, and apparent durability render them fit for any kind of building, and indeed for every other purpose except masts, for which, as I have already observed, they are too hard and too heavy. There is one in particular which, when we were up on the coast, was rendered conspicuous by a scarlet flower that seemed to be a compendage of many fibres. It is about as large as an oak, and the wood is exceedingly hard and heavy, and excellently adapted to the use of the millwright. There is another which grows in the swamps, remarkably tall and straight, thick enough to make masts for vessels of any size, and, if a judgment may be formed by the direction of its grain, very tough. This, which, as has been before remarked, our carpenter thought to resemble the pitch pine, may probably be lightened by tapping, and it will then make the finest masts in the world. It has a leaf not unlike a yew, and bears berries in small bunches. Great part of the country is covered with a luxuriant verdure, and our natural historians were gratified by the novelty, if not the variety, of the plants. Sow thistle, garden nightshade, one or two kinds of grass, the same as in England, and two or three kinds of fern, like those of the West Indies, with a few of the plants that are to be found in almost every part of the world, were all, out of about 400 species that have hitherto been described by any botanists, or had been seen elsewhere during the course of this voyage, except about 5 or 6 which had been gathered at Terra del Fuego. Of eatable vegetables there are but few. Our people, indeed, who had been long at sea, eat, with equal pleasure and advantage, of wild celery and a kind of cresses, which grew in great abundance upon all parts of the seashore. We also, once or twice, met with a plant like what the country people in England call lamb's quarters, or fat hen, which we boiled instead of greens. And once we had the good fortune to find a cabbage tree, which afforded us a delicious meal, and, except the fern root and one other vegetable, totally unknown in Europe, and which, though eaten by the natives, was extremely disagreeable to us, we found no other vegetable production that was fit for food among those that appeared to be the wild produce of the country. And we could find but 3 esculent plants among those which are raised by cultivation, yams, sweet potatoes, and cocoas. Of the yams and potatoes there are plantations consisting of many acres, and I believe that any ship which should happen to be here in the autumn, when they are dug up, might purchase them in any quantity. Gourds are also cultivated by the natives of this place, the fruit of which furnishes them with vessels for various uses. We also found here the Chinese paper mulberry tree, the same as that of which the inhabitants of the South Sea Islands make their cloth. But it is so scarce that though the New Zealanders also make cloth of it, they have not enough for any other purpose than to wear as an ornament in the holes which they make in their ears, as I have observed before. But among all the trees, shrubs, and plants of this country, there is not one that produces fruit, except a berry which has neither sweetness nor flavour, and which none but the boys took pains to gather, should be honoured with that appellation. There is, however, a plant that serves the inhabitants instead of hemp and flax, which excels all that are put to the same purpose in other countries. Of this plant there are two sorts. The leaves of both resemble those of flags, but the flowers are smaller and their clusters more numerous. In one kind they are yellow and in the other a deep red. Of the leaves of these plants, with very little preparation, they make all their common apparel. And of these they make also their strings, lines, and cordage for every purpose, which are so much stronger than anything we can make with hemp, that they will not bear a comparison. From the same plant, by another preparation, they draw long, slender fibres which shine like silk, and are as white as snow. Of these, which are also surprisingly strong, the finer clothes are made, and of the leaves, without any other preparation than splitting them into proper breadths and tying the strips together, they make their fishing nets, some of which, as I have before remarked, are of an enormous size. A plant which, with such advantage, might be applied to so many useful and important purposes, would certainly be a great acquisition to England, where it would probably thrive with very little trouble, as it seems to be hardy and to affect no particular soil, being found equally in hill and valley, in the driest mould and the deepest bogs. The bog, however, it seems rather to prefer, as near such places we observed it to be larger than elsewhere. I have already observed that we found great plenty of iron sand in Mercury Bay, and therefore that iron ore is undoubtedly to be found at no great distance. As to other metals, we had scarcely knowledge enough of the country for conjecture. If the settling of this country should ever be thought an object worthy the attention of Great Britain, the best place for establishing a colony would be either on the banks of the Thames or in the country bordering upon the Bay of Islands. In either place there would be the advantage of an excellent harbour, and, by means of the river, settlements might be extended and a communication established with the inland parts of the country. Vessels might be built of the fine timber which abounds in these parts, at very little trouble and expense, fit for such a navigation as would answer the purpose. I cannot indeed exactly assign the depth of water which a vessel intended to navigate this river, even as far up as I went with a boat, should draw, because this depends upon the depth of water that is upon the bar or flats, which lie before the narrow part of the river, for I had no opportunity to make myself acquainted with them. But I am of opinion that a vessel which should draw no more than 12 feet would perfectly answer the purpose. When we first arrived upon the coast of this country, we imagined it to be much better peopled than we afterwards found it, concluding that the inland parts were populous from the smoke that we saw at a considerable distance from the shore, and perhaps that may really be the case with respect to the country behind Poverty Bay and the Bay of Plenty, where the inhabitants appeared to be more numerous than in other places. But we had reason to believe that, in general, no part of the country but the sea coast is inhabited, and even there we found the people but thinly scattered. All the western coast from Cape Maria van Diemen to Mount Egmont being totally desolate, so that upon the whole the number of inhabitants bears no proportion to the extent of country. End of section 3. Section 4 of the First Voyage of James Cook, Volume 2, by James Cook, 1728 to 1779. Book 2, Chapter 9. A description of the inhabitants, their habitations, apparel, ornaments, food, cookery, and manner of life. The stature of the men in general is equal to the largest of those in Europe. They are stout, well-limbed, and fleshy, but not fat, like the lazy and luxurious inhabitants of the islands in the South Seas. They are also exceedingly vigorous and active, and have an adroitness and manual dexterity in an uncommon degree, which are discovered in whatever they do. I have seen the strokes of 15 paddles on a side in one of their canoes made with incredible quickness, and yet with such minute exactness of time, that all the rowers seem to be actuated by one common soul. Their colour in general is brown, but in few deeper than that of a Spaniard who has been exposed to the sun, in many not so deep. The women have not a feminine delicacy in their appearance, but their voice is remarkably soft. And by that, the dress of both sexes being the same, they are principally distinguished. They have, however, like the women of other countries, more airy cheerfulness and a greater flow of animal spirits than the other sex. Their hair, both of the head and beard, is black, and their teeth extremely regular and as white as ivory. The features of both sexes are good. They seem to enjoy high health, and we saw many who appeared to be of a great age. The dispositions both of the men and women seem to be mild and gentle. They treat each other with the tenderest affection, but are implacable towards their enemies, to whom, as I have before observed, they never give quarter. It may perhaps at first seem strange that where there is so little to be got by victory, there should so often be war, and that every little district of a country inhabited by people so mild and placid should be at enmity with all the rest. But possibly more is to be gained by victory among these people than at first appears, and they may be prompted to mutual hostilities by motives which no degree of friendship or affection is able to resist. It appears by the account that has already been given of them that their principal food is fish, which can only be procured upon the sea coast, and there in sufficient quantities only at certain times. The tribes, therefore, who live inland, if any such there are, and even those upon the coast, must be frequently in danger of perishing by famine. Their country produces neither sheep, nor goats, nor hogs, nor cattle. Tame fowls they have none, nor any art by which those that are wild can be caught in sufficient plenty to serve as provision. If there are any whose situation cuts them off from a supply of fish, the only succedaneum of all other animal food except dogs, they have nothing to support life but the vegetables that have already been mentioned, of which the chief are fern root, yams, clams, and potatoes. When by any accident these fail, the distress must be dreadful. And even among the inhabitants of the coast, many tribes must frequently be reduced to nearly the same situation, either by the failure of their plantations or the deficiency of their dry stock, during the season when but few fish are to be caught. These considerations will enable us to account not only for the perpetual danger in which the people who inhabit this country appear to live, by the care which they take to fortify every village, but for the horrid practice of eating those who are killed in battle, for the hunger of him who is pressed by famine to fight will absorb every feeling and every sentiment which would restrain him from allaying it with the body of his adversary. It may, however, be remarked that, if this account of the origin of so horrid a practice is true, the mischief does by no means end with the necessity that produced it. After the practice has been once begun on one side by hunger, it will naturally be adopted on the other by revenge. Nor is this all, for though it may be pretended, by some who wish to appear speculative and philosophical, that whether the dead body of an enemy be eaten or buried is in itself a matter perfectly indifferent, as it is, whether the breasts or thighs of a woman should be covered or naked, and that prejudice and habit only make us shudder at the violation of custom in one instance, and blush at it in the other. Yet leaving this as a point of doubtful disputation, to be discussed at leisure, it may safely be affirmed that the practice of eating human flesh, whatever it may be in itself, is relatively, and in its consequences, most pernicious, tending manifestly to eradicate a principle which is the chief security of human life, and more frequently restrains the hand of murder than the sense of duty, or even the fear of punishment. Among those who are accustomed to eat the dead, death must have lost much of its horror, and where there is little horror at the sight of death, there will not be much repugnance to kill. A sense of duty and fear of punishment may be more easily surmounted than the feelings of nature, or those which have been engrafted upon nature by early prejudice and uninterrupted custom. The horror of the murderer arises less from the guilt of the fact than its natural effect, and he who has familiarized the effect will consequently lose much of the horror. By our laws and our religion, murder and theft incur the same punishment, both in this world and the next.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.